Next question is from Marissa Lift Repeat. Can you please settle this nutritional question my husband and I have had for years? Is it better health-wise to eat the whole pan of brownies in one sitting or spread it out throughout the week?
Now, first before we answer this,
let's guess.
Do we think that the wife is on the eat the brownies?
No,
the
husband is just like me. Crushes the whole pan.
Eat the whole thing.
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking.
This is the reason why I keep stuff like that out of my house is I just don't have that self-discipline. Katrina... She can do this. She could bake brownies, and we could eat off of them for like the next month.
Just little pieces.
In fact, you know, it's funny. I have this client that this is tradition for her. She's done this her whole life. She's in her 50s, and she eats for her birthday month because she's not a big sweet eater. Her diet's in check. She looks phenomenal.
Not just the week, the month.
So the whole month, she eats cupcake every single day, but it's a quarter of a cupcake. She eats these little cupcakes. She cuts them in fours, and every day she just has one little. That's
good
like
for her.
Yo, it's great, and I don't tell her not to. I said that's great. I mean, she has the ability to manage that and keep that in check. And honestly, that is how if I was going to have a client eat it, you would much rather do that than to overconsume in one sitting.
On all levels, it is far less healthy. To eat a bunch at once rather than spread it out on all levels. Physiologically, it's worse.
Yeah.
You're overloading your body probably with extra calories, tons of sugar hitting the body, tons of potential food intolerance issues. You know, these types of foods tend to bother people's guts. Mm-hmm. And if you push a lot of them, you're probably going to have those kind of issues which cause inflammation. Let's also talk about the psychological factor.
Yeah.
That's binging, right? That's mm-hmm. encouraging this relationship with food where you overindulge all at once and you don't have the ability to enjoy it a little bit, but then also back off a little bit.
And then you punish yourself about it later, like inevitably. Like, so you go through it, you're mindless. You're not even really enjoying it as much as you're trying to get it in quickly because you know, you're just looking at it as an opportunity that's only right now for me to get all of this in. And it's not even as enjoyable as like really paying attention to the taste, the flavor, you know, all of that. It's just about getting it in.
Well, the truth is, too, it's important. I think you have self-awareness on why you have behaviors like that. And by no means am I pointing the finger here. This is my, to this day, you know, damn near 40 years old, and I'm very aware of this behavior in myself and still struggle with it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's when you have things that are so deeply rooted that go all the way back to childhood, you know, just becoming aware of your shit doesn't change it. Yeah, I still have to have this conversation. Anytime stuff like that is in my house, I know my behaviors. I know my habit when it comes to that, and I play my own mental mind games of justification. Oh, well, I trained really hard today, and I start having this like, you know, debate with myself on why it's okay for me to do it, and it's so funny. But it's like, so the easier thing for me, or the best way that I control this, is I keep it out of the house. I mean, that's for me, that's just the better approach. Yeah, I would love to have it in there and have the discipline to do a quarter. And have I done that before? Sure, I've done it, but I'm very susceptible to making up an excuse on why I think it's okay that I can smash the whole pan.
This is all rooted in for many people, it's rooted in the feeling that you're depriving yourself and restricting yourself.
Yeah.
And, you know, every time you don't eat sweets. So then when you do have the sweets, now you switch to a different mentality, which is, well, I already broke the first rule, which is never to have
these. Let it all in.
So now let's just go for it. The reality, what you should do, and this is kind of part of the practice, it ain't easy, but this is part of the practice of developing a better relationship with this, is to understand that you're choosing. You want to not eat it all the time. It is a choice. Here's the thing. If somebody forcibly takes something from you, it's much more difficult than if you voluntarily give it up. This is a fact. This is a total fact. Mm-hmm. Try getting an alcoholic to quit drinking when they're not voluntarily choosing to do so. It's almost impossible, even if they know it's good for them. They may even know in their mind, yeah, I probably should quit drinking, but that force feeling is what makes it a problem. So understand that when you choose not to eat these types of things, it's not because, ooh, I'm restricting myself and I need to really punish myself and push myself. It's, I don't want it. I don't want that. I know it's going to taste good. You can acknowledge all that. Yeah, I know it tastes good. I know I enjoy eating it. It's all good. But I choose not to because actually these other things are more important to me right now. And then when you have it, you have this conversation. Yeah, I choose to have it right now. I know some of the doesn't have these qualities, but also has these other qualities. And that's also totally fine. And then, you know, Justin talked about that binge, process. Next time you're caught, you catch yourself in that process of eating a lot of something, try to pay attention to this. This is a big one. Try to become aware of this. It isn't so much the food that you're tasting. It is the anticipation of the next bite. Mm. This is a very unique and strange quality of that binge mentality. It's not about the bite that I'm enjoying. It's about getting the next one. It's the anticipation of getting that next bite, which is why when you binge eat or you have this type of behavior, you tend to eat very quickly. Mm-hmm. You're not actually enjoying the brownies. You're waiting for the next one and the next one and the next one until it's all gone. And then you sit there and you're like, oh, what did I do?
I think it's really important you unpack it because honestly, that has nothing to do with why I do this. And I know that.
Yours is more unique, I would say.
Yeah, well, who knows though? Maybe more people can relate to this. They just never have thought about it like this. Like when I grew up and we were five kids, in a house and as a kid, right? So I'm not buying the groceries. Our parents are. If we got a, six pack of soda or we got a pint?
What's
of
ice cream.
Ice cream, yeah. What is it coming?
A gallon.
No, it's not a gallon. It's like a quart.
There you go.
Yeah, like a quart of ice cream or whatever.
A mile of ice cream. Yeah. Just use the wrong.
Are we talking metric? Are we talking standard? What are we doing here?
15 minutes of ice cream.
This much, right? So, a thing of Oreos. I mean, when you have five kids plus two adults that are and for us, it was a big deal, right? If my parents spent outside of the things that we absolutely needed to get some of the junk food or the treats like that, it was a big deal. And most boxes come with only 8 to 10 servings and fruit roll-ups and weird shit like that. So it was a race to get to it as fast as you could and have as much of it as you can before somebody else did. Because it might hit your house and you not get it. A six-pack of soda, you might not get one. You know what I'm saying? If someone decided to have two before you decided to have one, you're assed out.
Get it in real quick.
So you had to get it in. And I remember this was a long battle for me as a kid growing up. And then I remember becoming an adult and I had my own place by the time I was 17 and had a job, made my own money. I remember for me, I made the conscious effort. I'm going to fucking buy a whole quart and eat all of it because I can.
Yeah.
It had nothing to do with,
I think it's healthy for me?
Am I serving myself? No, it had everything to do with, I couldn't have it before. I can now. I make my own decision. I'm adult. I'm going to do it. Yeah, and I still struggle with that today as a grown-ass adult because I first went through all of it as a child. Then I went through my 20s of giving it to myself because I could and then justifying it because I trained hard, I worked out good, I didn't get fat from it. I balanced that out through playing sports and training and exercise. So this justification of I deserve this and I can do what I want. So that's the mental battle I have with it.
Yeah, it was a little bit more of a treasure hunt for me growing up because my dad would hide them in different places and cabinets and things and up on top of the refrigerator. And he thought that I'm going to work, I'm going to come back. And I would just start finding all of his treats around the house and start eating them. And he gets so pissed off. But, that was just one of those things. You held it in such high regard because it was why is he hiding it? Ooh, this is tasty. Dude, and it just became a thing.
These things become hardwired. Isn't that funny? The way you treat food in your house, your children become hardwired to eat that way. I mean, when I was a kid, and this is part of my parents' culture, the Italian culture. I mean, they grew up very poor. So you ate all your food because we don't know when the next time we're going to have a meal like this or whatever. Right. And so when we'd go to, and when I grew up, I wasn't without, right? My parents were, middle class. My dad worked very hard to provide us with a middle class lifestyle. So I have no experience growing up the way my dad did. So I don't know where this is coming from, or especially my grandparents. I mean, my grandfather, he eats, if you give him a bowl of boiling hot pasta, no joke, right off the stove, so hot, you stick your finger in there, it'll melt your skin off. Yeah. My grandfather eats the whole thing in three bites. He uses a fork and a spoon at the same time and eats it all. And this is because when he was a kid, he'd go to work at the age of, 10, 11, 12, literally go on a train and disappear for days at a time, come back with some money to give his mom. And he would get hired by these farms and landowners.
Like food lines, huh?
And what they would do is when they would feed the workers, they'd bring out a big, big, massive pot of boiling hot beans to feed everybody. And he's 12. He's working with a bunch of men. And if he didn't get in there and ate that boiling hot beans, by the time it cooled down, there'd be no food and he would starve. So he learned how to just inhale this hot ass food. This we joke with him and tell him his mouth is made of asbestos because he can just.
Yeah.
But when we would eat at my grandma's house, me and my cousins, so there's you know, six of us, seven of us, a lot of us, we would all sit outside in the patio and my grandma would serve us the food. And then she would come out and she'd have money. This is no joke, dude. This was a kid. This is terrible. This is a terrible thing to teach a kid. But she would come out with money and she'd say, the first person to finish gets a dollar. So we'd be like, you know, just training us
shoveling
to eat
it in so bad.
Super fast. You know what I mean? Or she'd put a timer. All right, when this is up, if you're not done, you're in trouble. Oh, yeah. I got 5 seconds left.
Different times, man.
I need to finish eating this, you know? So you end up developing these you know, these bad eating habits. So, but yeah, this is something that you want to become aware of and unpack it. And for me, it was paying attention to the fact that it wasn't about the food that was in my mouth. It was about the next one. I remember when that first hit me, and as I was eating, I'm like, wait a minute, I'm not even enjoying what's in my mouth.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about the next one.
Trying to get it all.
This is kind of stupid.